ringside for Stampede Wrestling next on VU 13.
Everybody, and away we go with another edition of the Stampede Wrestling Show.
I don't believe it. Ed Whalen and Jim Davies in stereo. You got it all here for this edition of the show, and it's great to have you with us. And Jimbo, I'm looking forward to some fun.
There's going to be quite some moments of excitement a little later on when Davy Boy and Dynamite Kid make their proud return to Stampede Wrestling.
All right, for openers, we've got the return of Mike Hammer, young man out of St. Louis, Missouri, bends the beams at 215. He's in against a much bigger man, Rick Patterson, Minnesota, 239 pounds. This is one fall. There is a 15-minute time limit, and we're just past the 5-minute mark. Third man in the ring, Rod Hayter. Yes, indeedy-do. We have the Dynamite Kid and Davy Boy Smith back in the territory. And you know, the sweep that wrestling has become across North America is totally stunning, isn't it?
Certainly is. One of the things that we're a little disappointed but proud at the same time of tonight is that we're missing the world's strongest man, Tom McGee. He's off in Portugal at a world's strongest man competition.
Well, he's got enormous strength. I don't know if he'll come back with the old red eyeballs again, but I might explain to you that last time that happened to him, it was because he had been lifting 1,700 pounds. Unbelievable.
And I was looking forward to him being here throughout the winter just in case he could pull my car out of the snow.
He could do that. Rick Patterson rallying now against Mike Hammer. Let's concentrate on the fight. I like this Patterson. Hammer is well known in this territory, although he has not fought in a while. I wonder if he is wondering at this moment about his comeback, because Patterson has been banging him from pillar to post. As per usual, our timekeeper tonight, Tommy Carr, relative rookie. He's only been doing the job for, what is it, 38 years.
Just a veritable infant.
Hammer down on that deck, Patterson working him over.
Yeah, Hammer is getting hammered in there. And we're not talking ball peen.
Now off those ropes, look out, Nelly! He caught him beautifully. Slammed that elbow, makes the cover. It's a one, two, and that's all. Very agile, Rod Hayter, the referee.
Rick Patterson never stops surprising us, Ed, with his movement, but he used to be a star basketball player in the prep schools in Minnesota.
That accounts for that flexibility, that agility that he possesses. Good young man. Incidentally, as part of the crowd tonight, we have 100 youngsters on a first-come, first-served basis. But there were many lined up outside this building, far more than the 100, I might add. Oh, let me see. It would be nearly 2 hours before the show was to get underway. Dan Crawford, with his tickets, let the first 100 in free. And, of course, those tickets were financed by a fellow by the name of J.R. Foley. Boy, did he get taken to the cleaners last week.
He certainly did, Ed, and Crawford told me he loves spending J.R. Foley's money.
I can understand that feeling. Hammer coming back a bit. Patterson struggling.
Interesting name, Mike Hammer. I'm sure I've heard it somewhere before.
Are you really? Can't believe that. Look out, the turnaround now. Oh, just a minute. Drives him off. Those ropes get thrown back. Wanted to pull him down. Good maneuver by Patterson, but it kind of fell apart. And banging him in the corner. Again off those ropes. Boy, this is an athletic match. Just grazed him on the chest. Enough to knock him down. Well, Hammer's dead, but he won't lie down. He'll lie down now. It's one, two, three. He got
it. It's all over.
In bout number one, the Great Gama. You're having a little rest tonight. They won't let you fight.
Well, let's just say I'm not too happy about the situation at all.
You're suspended, right?
Suspended for no reason whatsoever. All I can say is it's a conspiracy on the part of Stu Hart, Bruce Hart, the Dynamite Kid, and yourself, boss.
Me?
Even you, Ed Whelan. All I can say is that last week, Bruce Hart was the one that knocked the referee out. He's the one that should have been suspended. I should be the one wearing that Commonwealth title out here. I'm the uncrowned Commonwealth and the mid-heavyweight champion of the world. The Dynamite Kid is here tonight. And this is the main reason I came back to the Calgary area with the hopes of fighting the Dynamite Kid. Well, he very easily, very luckily, somehow managed to talk the referees and Stu Hart and Bruce Hart and getting me suspended so he wouldn't have to face me. But sooner or later, one of these days, you are going to have to face me for that title, Dynamite Kid. And I'm going to be here a long, long time, and I'm going to take that title away from you.
Well, Mr. Whelan, don't look all surprised. You know what's going on. Here is the true Commonwealth champion.
Yes.
What's the matter with you? Here's where the belt belongs, right? Gamma Singh's waist.
I'm not going no place, Sean. I'm going to be right here. Whether he fights me tonight, whether he fights me next week, next month, next year, I'm going to be right here waiting for him.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. A couple of guys doing a little crying tonight, aren't you? Yeah. Well, there's about a ton of fun, I would think, in that ring. A big man who travels by the name of Mike Shaw weighs in at 360 pounds out of Saginaw, Michigan, against Mr. Hito, Tokyo, Japan, 230 pounds, Wayne Hart, the referee. Mike Shaw, not exactly one of the more lovable characters of the ring, but he's a big chunk of character, is he not?
He certainly is. I think last time we saw Mike Shaw, he was climbing up the Empire State Building swatting airplanes. He's a big boy.
This is one fall, a 20-minute time limit. And we're halfway between the 5 and 10-minute mark. Mike Shaw, Saginaw, Michigan, Mr. Hito, Tokyo, Japan. Very big crowd here. Hito has always shown enormous courage and great stick-to-itiveness.
And I see, Ed, that Mike Shaw has got J.R. Foley in his corner, making a lot of noise. J.R. always walks into the room voice first.
That's a good description. Meantime, Hito is getting the squeeze put on him by the big man. I'm trying to recall, but I don't recall any time in which Hito submitted. You had to knock him out or count him out. I never saw him give in to a submission hold. seen him in a fight or ten. Again. You know, you often have said to me at ringside, Jim Davies, that you wonder about the backs with some of these wrestlers, the way they get jammed into those turnbuckles and body slammed.
They get slammed into the turnbuckles, body slammed, thrown out in the apron, as Mr. Hedo just did by Mike Shaw. And I cannot believe that these guys are still walking around. J.R. Foley, a little extracurricular activity, slams Mr. Hedo's head into the apron. And J.R. looking the picture of innocence.
One fall. We're nearing the 10-minute mark. Mr. Hedo trying to shake the cobwebs out. Mike Shaw awaiting his arrival. We are at the 10-minute mark. I might just remind the people of Lethbridge, that the stars of Stampede Wrestling will be there by the 28th of this month. 28th, okay? And look for them to come to Cranbrook and Kimberly.
And Ed, Mr. Hedo is getting quite a working over by Mike Shaw. Mike Shaw, of course, people mostly meet him in nightmares. He is one mean dude. And a lot of them. He's Stampede Wrestling's answer to the refrigerator.
That's a very accurate description. Matter of fact, I think he's got more cubic footage than my Westinghouse, this guy. You see what I mean about Hedo? He will not submit. He just keeps hammering away. Comes the big slam. Oh, no. Oh, no.
Ooh. That is 360 pounds.
Here we go.
Of Mike Shaw. Oh!
He's going to have to go to a movie where there's standing room only. My goodness, that was a one-point landing. And you know which point it was.
Not a terribly pretty one.
Hedo rallying now, comes off those ropes, hammers away at his man. Look at him go to work. Oh, this is a gut fighter. Is a good fighter. Crowd loves it. Big headbutt. Shaw's barely hanging on. Whammo! What a performance here by Hedo. Crowd says more, 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 more.
Bit of hair there, Ed.
Boy, if he splashes him off. Oh, no. 1, 2, 3. And a very thin Mr. Hedo succumbs to Mike Shaw. Let's look at that great big flipping body coming off the ropes in slow motion and flattening his man, Hedo. Ouch.
And Mike Shaw makes Mr. Hedo into a living pancake. Okay, wrestling fans, Stampede Wrestling is coming to the Vancouver P&E Gardens Wednesday, December 4th at 7:30. Leo Burke and Hubert Glant are taking on Rotten Ron Star and Hockey.
But on December 4th, Bad News Allen, because I never will never forget what you did to me and the incompetent manager, J.R. Foley.
Kerry Brown.
Let's get down to the business now, Jim Davies. Let's get down to the real business.
Rotten Ron Star and Honky Tonk Wink.
Burke and Gallant tried and tried to get these belts. They cost us a match, but we didn't lose the belts. Burke and Gallant, if you ever want these belts, you're going to have to beat us for them. You understand that? You got to beat us, and we can't be beat. We're the best. Rotten Ron Star owns Vancouver. That's his town.
It's my town. Nobody, including Bad News Island, Burke, Gallant, or anyone's running us out.
When Stampede Wrestling comes to the Peony Gardens in Vancouver, Leo Burke and Hubert Glant are going to be taking on Rotten Ron Starr and Honky Tonk Wayne. Leo, how do you feel about that?
Well, I understand we're going into Ron Starr's town, Vancouver, B.C. Now, I don't know if it's Ron Starr's town or not, but I do know one thing. They're going to be ours come Vancouver. They've been doing a lot of things to a lot of people. Someone has to put a stop to it, and I feel that Hubert and I are the right combination that can do the job.
Hubert, how do you feel about that?
Listen, Ron Starr and Honky Tonk Wayne, we both realize, Lou and I both realize you're a tough team. You're saying you can't be beat, but come to Vancouver, and it's going to be the time that you are going to get beat.
Thanks very much, Hubert. And Leo?
Hey. Why are 40% of today's marriages ending in divorce? How do you deal with alcoholism? What are the warning signs of depression? Does God really answer prayer? These are just some of the questions which will be discussed in the new season of 100 Humphrey Street. Join host David Maines as he welcomes people from different backgrounds who will share their answers to today's questions. It's a brand new season of 100 Humphrey Street. Watch for it. At this time, on this station.
Come on, Terminator! Get rid of him! Up there is a dollar for you! Come on!
I would get a word in edgewise if that J.R. Foley would shut up. But at any rate, it's Stan Crawford in the ring. He's against the Terminator, a 262-pounder out of East Berlin. This is a $1,000 bounty match, and Foley is yelling about how he'll give the Terminator $1,000 in a bounty match to get rid of Crawford. And you know the story of Crawford.
We sure do, Ed. I'll tell you, J.R. Foley is still steamed at the fact that we had a double defection on our hands last week, and Dan Crawford suddenly turned on his own opponent, Mike Shaw, and now, or on his own ally, Mike Shaw, and now he's away from the army. He infiltrated and escaped alive.
Well, I was very pleased. I thought that all was right with the world again when Dan Crawford was found to be going straight. It reinforced my sincere belief that mankind isn't half bad after all.
And the universe is still ticking as we know it.
Yes, it is. Well,
it's interesting.
Interesting
listening to Foley at the sideline. We could use this guy as an air raid siren.
Well, he's sure screaming a lot. But right now, the Terminator is beginning to do a little work. We are moving toward the five-minute mark. Referee, Rod Heater, 1:30.
Crawford is going to have his hands full with this big Terminator. 260 pounds from Berlin. He is one big, mean boy.
Boy, what a terrific crowd here.
Of course, there's 100 youngsters that are all cheering for Dan Crawford, youngsters that he personally gave tickets to, thanks to J.R. Foley's cash.
Dan Crawford and the Terminator, the crowd chanting for Crawford. Crawford banging up, couple of right hands, the third one, the fourth one, trying to work his way out of that arm. Having great difficulty so doing.
He's so scared, Ed Whelan, he doesn't know how to lace his boots up.
Terry Brown trying to add a little, as is J.R. Foley.
This place is a bedlam.
I'm not sure if you know it, but the Terminator has entered several of the same World's Strongest Man contests as Tom McGee, and although he's come out second best on several occasions, he claims to be the World's Strongest Man.
Yeah, well, the record books will show you it's Tom McGee. That we know for sure. Well, it was
was a rouser. As it turned out, J.R. Foley conked Dan Crawford on the noggin with that helmet of his. The referee in the ring said it was the Terminator's win, but the senior referee, Wayne Hart, saw it, and you got the decision.
I think it's an appropriate time to say that justice prevailed. It's too bad, I guess, the match wasn't on television, but I would have to think that the officiating tonight was sharp. They were alert, they were there, and they caught it, and that's great. He's a big, tough guy. I don't want anybody watching this show to underestimate this guy. This guy is rugged. He showed a lot here tonight. And as I say, it's a shame it didn't show his match. I want to tell you something else about him. I spent a week under Foley's wing, and he told me a lot of stuff that this viewing audience is going to love to hear, and it's going to take me a few weeks to tell you. But for openers, this guy's name is not Toots Jorgensen. His name is Hubert Cecil or Cecil or something, and he's from Victoria, British Columbia. And I have reason to believe that maybe there's a bounty on his head. I don't know. But he changed his name. Foley brought him in here under false pretenses. And Foley told me last week, he said, that really isn't his name. Don't tell anybody. Well, I can't keep it a secret.
Okay, Dan. Good seeing you.
Thanks very
good much. Good match. Dan Crawford. You betcha. Well, the $1,000 bounty trick didn't work. You got caught.
Wait a minute, Mr. Whalen. Suppose I'm concerned. The Terminator did let me down. He doesn't get no $1,000. But I'm bringing in the heavy artillery next week. It's Big Mike Shaw, and he will be getting the bounty money. Wait a minute, I'd not finish yet. Wait a minute, look here. And here, Mike, you will be very interested. This is a doctor's report about Dan Crawford, of his doctor. Very big friend of mine, the doctor. He has that bad of a back, he should not be wrestling. Also, a wound shot in the arm.
Oh, really?
You play on those, Mike. So just
you. Tell you what, that little wound shot in the arm, he's going to wish he got hit with a Gatling gun when I get done with him next week. He's going to want to go someplace, and he'd rather be in with a bazooka than what he's going to have next week. Paulie's going to spend his last cent on that useless Crawford, because I'm going to be all over him. He'll never want to wrestle again, Whalen. I don't care if they offer him all of Calgary, $1 million, nothing. He's never going to come back here.
Yeah, all right, all right.
You think General Patton had some ideas. Wait till you see OJR Paul. Is going to work against Dan Crawford. Have you been to this, Terminator?
I won the match fair and square. There's no reason at all why the Crawford's hand was raised in victory. That $1,000 bounty should be mine right now.
No.
All right.
I put the money up next week for Big Mike Shaw.
Big Mike Shaw. All right.
If you're a man and your hair is thinning, there's a center just for you. Klein. Our exclusive Klein Grow Hair Loss Control Program has helped thousands like you achieve a fuller, thicker, and healthier head of hair. So why not come into Klein's today? Someone you know will be glad you did.
The reason a Carter company can guarantee customer satisfaction is people. It's people like these and others whose commitment to excellent service have made Carter the first name in transportation in Vancouver. So remember, when you deal with any one of the Carter family of companies, there's always great people standing behind you.
Sorry, it was just a table. Can I help you up?
September evening, and we're leaving for the ballet. The night we had our last scuppered. We got some time, and so we find a little cafe. The night we had our last scuppered. They bring the wine, and she says, it's très enchanté. The night we had our last scuppered. Like the wine, the night was fine. On to the ballet, the night we had our last scuppered.
Hey, Homer, it's that time I'm going to retire.
Retire? You'll never retire. Never.
Eventually, everybody's got to retire. And when you retire, you want a place that's going to treat you right, that's going to give you the best tires for your car, your driving, and your money.
Damned if he didn't retire after all.
Look at Hubert Gallant go to work. He has cleared the ring. It's Hubert Gallant and Leo Burke against the Cuban assassin and Butch Moffat. One fall, 45-minute time limit. We're nearing the 10-minute mark, and it's Wayne Hart as the referee. Boy, I do hope you've taken your Dr. Chase's nerve medicine tonight, Jim.
I'm going to need it. I'll tell you, it's a strange partnership, this Cuban assassin and Butch Moffat. Cuban assassin, of course, having his hair done by Hurricane Hazel, whereas Butch Moffat has his done by Permashine.
Yes, it is a combination, all right. That's handsome Hubert Gallant, the 217-pounder, Canadian out of Shediac, New Brunswick. Moffat now makes Detroit home. The assassin, the Cuban assassin, I guess his hometown is rather obvious. It's Havana. And Leo Burke, Moncton, New Brunswick, Canada. Wayne Hart, the referee.
Cuban assassin has been using his belt on his opponents when not watched by the referee. It's interesting, when the Cuban assassin was born, they didn't know whether to buy a crib or a cage.
You're mean. I understand. Here comes the assassin. Oh, speaking of mean. Those ropes down, over the top and over the top again, and Willow, one, two, not quite, thanks to interference. Spectacular work by Hubert Gallant. Boy, this guy's a worker.
But with Butch Moffat size 12s doing their job, Hubert is in a little bit of trouble.
One fall, 45-minute time limit.
It's interesting, Leo Burke and Hubert Gallant have once again been communicating in French from the tag team corners, mystifying their opponents. Mind you, I think you could mystify these guys with English.
Cuban assassin is into that ring. Double whammy here.
Hubert Gallant having some rib problems right now. Whoa!
Boy, that is a rough landing. Cover one. Two more bouts on the card. Come on, you can come back. Hold this head close. Come back. And we're awaiting the appearance, of course, of Dynamite Kid and Davey Boy Smith.
But they won't have a picnic yet against Honky Tonk Wayne and Rotten Ron Starr. Those are two of the meanest hombres in these parts.
Hear that right hand banging on the jaw.
Referee Wayne Hart having an awful lot of trouble keeping it a one-on-one in the ring, as we can see right here.
Now he's driving his man off the ropes. Whoops, he missed. Just went over the top, just missed it. Now, there is
the sleeper.
Off the rope, let it stick, I don't think. Tag, and it's Gallant. Gallant into the... Abdominal stretch, he's got it on him. Well, everybody's getting into the act. Everybody's after it. Supposed to be in there. Referee says it's Moffitt. And Gallant, but look at this. A wrong number. The cover. It's a one. It's a two. It's a three.
It's all over.
Oh, what a win. We gotta see in slow motion how the Cuban assassin messed it up.
And the Cuban assassin drives his own man, Butch Moffitt, right in the head, and it's over.
Well, it's my pleasure to introduce Desiree Peterson to the crowd, and you're right smack out of Calgary. I know you've hit Madison Square Gardens and many other places by storm. Aren't you half of the tag team championship combination?
Yes, I am. Half of the world's tag team champion is the process. Velvet McIntyre is my partner. She will not be here with me. And I'm proud to be home in Calgary, my hometown, to wrestle. And I'm hoping that people will back me up totally.
Well, I understand you what? You're appearing here hopefully in a couple of weeks.
In a couple of weeks, yes, I will be.
I bumped into a lady by the name of Rhonda Singh in the crowd. You don't suppose she's hunting, is she?
She might be hunting, but she's got a lot farther to hunt.
Okay, Desiree, it's wonderful to see you here. I applaud the success you've had elsewhere.
Thank you.
It'll be a thrill to see you in the ring.
Thank you very much, Ed Whalen.
Thank you. Desiree Peterson. Peterson, I'll get it. I'm tongue-tied. I really am. Well, it's a real pleasure to welcome back to the local scene Davey Boy Smith and the Dynamite Kid, and there's a couple of hombres locally who have been talking about you.
There's a lot of people talking about me and the Dynamite Kid, the British Bulldogs, Ed. But we're here today in Calgary to come and show all these people who the real tag team champions are, you know. We got the belts taken away because we didn't give anybody a championship match in Calgary within 90 days. Me and the Dynamite Kid, we've been working out every day at BJ's gym, and we've been working out ready for this match, and I think tonight we can take these belts, Ed.
Well, Dynamite.
You know something, Mr. Whalen? We've been around the world, we've been in New York, Australia, different places. We've wrestled some tough competition. There's one thing, you can never underestimate a tag team at any time. Honky Tonk Wayne Ferris, Ron Starr. We don't take you lightly. We know you're tough competitors. But the thing is, the Dynamite Kid and Dave Boy Smith are back in Calgary to prove one more thing to all these people out here, that we still are the best. We're going to beat you tonight. We're going to come back for those championship belts. We're going to take them. Like David said, we've been working out in BJ's gym all week long. We're ready, we're prepared and able to do damage. Tonight we're going to do it.
One more thing, Ed. I'd like to thank all the people tonight for coming out and supporting the British Bulldogs, me and the Dynamite Kid.
Peepers on Kerry Brown. There's a lot to feast on there at nearly 270 out of Kansas City. Jerry Morrow, the man from Martinique, now very proud to be a Canadian, making his home in Vancouver and tipping the Toledos at 232. We're nearing the 10-minute mark. Wayne Hart is the referee.
How are you, baby? How are you?
and it's one fall with a 45-minute time limit. The 10-minute mark.
Okay, Ed, we have the letter of the week here to Stampede Wrestling. It says our whole family watched Stampede Wrestling live and on TV here in Regina. Some time ago, I wagered my father as to the Cobra's true identity, the height, weight, physique, complexion, accent, everything, all looks to me like the Cobra is none other than Hurricane Fidel Castillo. Even their autographs are suspiciously familiar. Can anyone tell me if I'm correct? And it's signed, thanks your fan, Jerome Grayburn.
All right. I don't know about that identification. I don't think so. But right now, let's concentrate on Terry Brown against Terry Morrow. Morrow making the big comeback here. The crowd loves every minute of it. Big slam. Morrow coming off those ropes, goes to the opposite.
By Jerry Morrow.
Oh!
Jerry Morrow is the proud father of triplets, young girls, and he's going to town for those young'uns right now.
Yeah, he's going to go the aerial route. Here he comes! Oh, he caught it on the side. Well, it's unbelievable. One, two. Oh, he kicked out. I thought it was a slow count.
Looked like 2 3/4 to me, Ed.
Boy, I thought it was a slow count. I thought he had the 3 on him. Morrow off those ropes now. Knocks his man down. That takes a lot of knocking because you're dealing at the 270 level. Kerry Brown, Jerry Morrow.
Foley just pulled Jerry Morrow out of the ring.
Pulled him out. Oh, they're going to wipe it out because of the interference. They are going to wipe it out because of the interference. Just a minute. Just a minute. Who are they giving the decision to, John? Are they giving it to Kerry Brown? Kerry Brown was given the decision.
He told me he grabbed his trunks on the way out.
No, he never touched a guy at all. As people, you watch the monitors tomorrow and you'll see what happens.
How can you stand there and lie? How can you stand there and lie? He did it.
My bought and paid time, so you get out of here. Mr. Whalen, now, supposedly there was supposed to be a tournament to establish the fact that there is a North American champion here in the territory, but Davey Boy Smith has been watching the tube, just as everybody else has, and he saw what Mr. Brown is doing, and so he brought a partner, and he wrote Stu Hart into making it a tag match. Well, this I don't like very much, Mr. Whalen. I don't like this. Davey Boy Smith, it's just a matter of time before you have to face me. And I hope you people out in television land aren't half as ignorant as these people, because this is Canada's finest athlete, even though I am American, and this is the best manager in the world.
Even though he's British.
So other good times are all ahead.
Listen to the crowd.
And you can see now,
time.
I can't hear it very good.
Yeah, I know.
Money does talk, Mr. Whalen.
Sure it does.
Now as I've got that bounty going on you-know-who, Cromit, my big man next week, Mike Shaw.
Yeah.
Maria from Antigua said to say hi.
Well, is that cute? A lot of fans in Antigua watch this.
You want to go to a party?
I don't want to go to a party, not your party. Ron Starr and Honky Tonk Wayne. This is the 15-minute mark, and that's Dynamite going after Honky Tonk. Davey Boy Smith in that ring now against Ron Starr.
15 minutes gone. 15 minutes.
Bastion, ever since the beginning of the match, I've never seen anything like that. I'm flabbergasted, but I must say, don't mind to admit that I do root for Davey Boy Smith and Dynamite Kid. I hope to become new champions tonight.
Well, that's the voice of Leo Burke, who's sitting with me at ringside. Jim Davis, this is one of the best matches I've seen.
I'll tell you what, that Dynamite Kid is like a man possessed, a man that size, that fast, unbelievable.
What is happening here now? Ron Starr in a bit of difficulty in the opposite corner. The same can be said for Honky Tonk Wayne. And referee Hater's having a little trouble trying to keep things under control here. Leo Burke, an interested spectator, you'd like a shot at the belts no matter who's got it.
You bet. That's why Hubert and I are here keeping a close eye on them. We want the talented winner regardless of who wins the match.
Stu Hart would even allow him on the premises.
Well, there he is at ringside. There he is. Allen is stepping into the ring. Ron Starr saying, give Dynamite a shot.
Seems to have done a complete about face.
Yes, he has. And he's clean house. And the crowd. I'm waiting for the decision by the referee. The belts will stay with Honky Tonk Wayne and Ron Starr. It's ruled a disqualification.
That's it for you, Baldy. That's it for him, Ed Whalen. Nobody does that to the Mafia.
Dynamite Kid. Oh, what a match that was, but what a schmozzle at the end.
You know something, Ed? Time after time, place after place, we're coming into these situations where we're going to the ring trying to wrestle, trying to beat the people. Well, the thing is, we got these other wrestlers interfering, jumping in the ring, jumping out of the ring. It gets confused, the people confused, we're confused. We're going for a pinfall, 1, 2, 3. We can't get it. But let me tell you one thing, Mr. Whalen. We're going to be away for a short time. But when we do come back to Calgary, we will demand a rematch with Honky Tonk Wayne Ferris, Ron Starr. You can rent the corral or the saddle room, whatever you want. When we come back, we want a cage match. with the top sealed so nobody can get in, nobody can get out. The British Bulldogs are going to come back and prove to the people that we are the real champions. And the only way to do that is to get in the steel cage, seal the top off, where nobody gets in or out until there's a winner.
That's right, Ed Whelan. Next time we're in Calgary, any kind of match, I don't want just a normal wrestling match. I want to come back in a street fight or a cage match. All these people know the British Bulldogs were number one when he was in Calgary and number one when they left Calgary, and they're the back. And one more thing, I'd like to thank Leo and Hubert for what they did tonight. They tried to stop him from going out, but as usual, they run back to the dressing room, Ed. You can't do nothing about it.
Okay, well, listen, let me... And it's good to see you guys one more here, thing. By the way.
You know something? Everybody knows out there that Leo the Lion is the king of his crew. But his brother Hubert is the fine son of a gun too, and now they've got something to say.
Okay.
I just want to say one thing, Ed. I know these two gentlemen wrestled on before. I know they don't want to win the way they did tonight. We're left in the middle. As you know, I just wanted to come here to challenge the winners. They came about, we just defended ourselves. All I can say is I'm sorry to Dynamite and Davey Boy.
Okay, well,
looking forward to get a chance of Honky Tonk and Ron Starr again.
Okay, thank you, guys. Well, we had a strange thing happen here in the arena. Bad News Allen on the scene apologized for the kind of wrestling he perpetrated in this ring before. Said he had had a letter from his grandfather.
Nobody wants to hear that, Whelan. Listen, Bad News Allen, you watch your TV. You watch it tomorrow. Because I'm publicly challenging you in front of thousands of people in television land. You don't do that to me. I don't care if you're green, blue, or black. You don't do it to me.
All right, what is this? It's casual.
Look who's wearing a belt. Do we look like somebody that's worried? Do we, Ed Whelan? We successfully defended our belts against the British Bulldogs tonight. We came out victorious, no matter what anybody says, no matter what the public says, the Canadian people, Brian Mulroney, or anybody, we won the match. Now, let me say this, Ed. There's always somebody sticking their nose in where they don't belong. And you know who that was. Your friend, Leo Burke and Hubert Glant. Now, they're friends of yours, Ed. I don't mind that, but they shouldn't have stuck their nose in.
They cost us the match. We kept the belts, but they cost us the match, Whelan. They attacked us on the floor. We took everything the British Bulldogs could throw at us and more. Now, I'm going to tell you something. If these two want to stick their nose in our business where it don't belong, then believe me, I'm the man that'll bite it off. Now, they cost us the match technically tonight, so I tell you what, Mr. Whelan, see how tough these guys are. They had Bad News Allen standing in the background. We're not afraid of Allen. We're not afraid of the British Bulldogs. They got nothing they can do to us. They can headbutt us. They can put the big man in there. He can headbutt me all they want. Give it to me, Wayne. Give it to me, Wayne. Give it to me, Wayne. There's nothing they can do to hurt us. There's no way. Give me Gallant and give me Burke and the tag team. And then if there's anything left, we'll take whoever else comes.
All right. Jimmy, I don't believe this night. What has been going on here?
Standing room only. He's only taking the chairs away from everybody. I can't believe these guys.
Well, this was an incredible night. I enjoyed it. It was a spectacle.
I couldn't believe Bad News Allen's return. It was awesome. The man is still raring to go.
Well, I'm quite happy that he says that he is through with the bad news part, okay?
He's talking reformed. He's talking good news, Allen.
Good news, Allen. That might be off, right? Well, I hope it'll be good news when we see you next week at the same time. We'll look forward to it then. I want to thank Jim Davies as being a color man once again for us, and I want to invite you to join us next week, same time, same station. But in the meantime, and in between time, that's it. Another edition. One thing.